Welcome to the Jerrell Riggins Show, the program that explores various subjects, including business, health and wellness, music, technology, and current events. I am your host, Jerrell Riggins. Our guest today is Russell Holmes, State Representative for the Sixth Suffolk District. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Please share with our listening audience a little bit on your background.
Yes, so I was elected in 2010. I've been in office since 2010, as I'm now in my 13th year. I have the honor of representing parts of Mattapan, Dorchester, Hyde Park, Rosendale, and JP. And today I sit on the Ways and Means Committee, the Bonding Committee, which is a committee that looks at all of the capital spending for the Commonwealth on global warming or climate change. And I'm also on the internal committee as one of the vice chairs that are the operations here in the building. But I'm a Mattapan resident and have been in Mattapan most of my life and just honored to serve.
Oh, great. Great to have you. Thank you so much. I want to kind of chat a little bit about your constituents and financial literacy and some things you may have seen as a state representative. Shana Lear, she's a certified financial planner and author of the book Money on Purpose, and she mentions we have money to do four main things: to spend, save, give, and invest. And they are the primary uses of money, and they must be pursued in balance. Having an imbalanced approach to how we use money can lead to a financial disaster. And I just kind of wanted to lead off that with that for our conversation today, because one thing that I was thinking, a budget is a tool used to plan and evaluate spending patterns, a roadmap to increase the chances of reaching a destination. In talking with some of your constituents, do you see they put budgets together and trying to plan for home purchases and other things, just from your background and experience?
Well, I'm glad you asked the question, because ironically, we're going through the budget season now here at the State House. And so often my constituents will call me about day-to-day issues, what's going to happen with a bus stop, or what's going to happen with if they lose their homes or lose their housing. But very few actually ask me about a budget. And then when I ask them about the things we're doing in the budget, it is very unfamiliar to them. And so when I think about what happens, whether it be the CFP made those recommendations about what to do with the money, too often folks in my district are just on one side of that, and that is the spend side. We are very much consumers, but not very good savers. And so when I have many conversations with folks, I'm trying to encourage them to not have it so that the one place that they're going to have funds when they retire will be just Social Security. I try to remind them Social Security was never intended to be the only source of income you had in retirement. That Social Security, when it was first been established, was really to help supplement two other very important pieces of the three-legged stool, if there's not a better way of saying it, and that is you should have your own savings. And at the time when Social Security was being established, most people had very much an alliance with their companies, and they had pensions. And so Social Security, unfortunately, today is the only source of income for many, many people, and they don't have a pension or their own savings. And so, yes, I talk about this often, as well as I talk about one of the other things that we have in the community, and that is ownership of our homes. We're blessed. Many of us have the ownership of our homes, but we do very poor planning. Just before this podcast, I was talking to a young lady who mother passed away 10, 12 years ago, at least. Mm-hmm. And then her brother was the executor of the estate, and now she's the executor of the estate, and she didn't have the bandwidth to understand just the logistics, more the experience to understand the logistics of then how to go and get appointed as the executor, and then to finally become the personal representative. And so I was able to begin that process with her to help her to get to the Suffolk probate, because she has been paying a mortgage, literally, Gerald, for 12 years.
Wow.
And never even knows the balance of the mortgage, doesn't even know it. She lives in the home, and the mortgage is very reasonable. It's $850 a month, thereabout. but she doesn't know the balance. It's actually just went over from one servicer to another servicer. And all she knows is that it's the estate of her mom. They owe this money and doesn't know the balance, never been able to refinance it, and have, unfortunately, some of the people in her family have passed away. And so now is a home that's owned by her, our brother, and her her nephew and niece. So these financial issues come up all the time. And so we have to do a much better, we have to create much better plans in our community.
Wow. So basically she's in the spend give mode instead of the save invest, if I understand you correctly.
And well, what was great is the mom felt like it was excellent to leave something to her family, which was very important. It's mm-hmm. like for you or she was certainly thinking wise, but and she actually had a will and she did a great job of planning. But then the folks in the next generation didn't execute the plan. And so we need to save, invest, absolutely, but we then also need to be thinking about our futures.
Yeah, because how we leave a legacy. I mean, she seems like she did a great job in planning, but now to the next generation, how will they do the same thing and leave it in legacy? Correct. Yeah. Do you have any suggestions?
Because sometimes...
Go ahead.
I'm sorry to cut you off there, but sometimes what we expect our children to do or what I've seen is not what they do. And so you believe that you're leaving a legacy and not knowing that the legacy you're leaving is a legacy of division and fight amongst the family. And it might have just been better to have the intention of having the property sold, and then everyone could then take their part of the property and then their proceeds from the property and then move forward their lives. Unfortunately, what I've seen often in this role is that there are some people in the family doing better than others, and those that are not doing as well seem to then go and feel as though they need to occupy the house, then they don't pay the rent in that house, and then the house falls into disrepair. And then the folks who are doing better say, I'm not going to be associated with the house because of the fact that someone else is living there, and why should I pay for my brother or my nephew and the like? And so I've seen it happen very often, and they call the state house, and we try our best to work through them.
Okay. If you had an opportunity to share with some of your constituents or maybe set up some financial literacy workshops to get them to understand about putting together a monthly budget, how would you think they would respond to such a suggestion and resource that you're trying to provide to your constituents to know how to manage their money better and save and invest?
Well, it depends on wherever they are in life. I find ABCD does it, and mm-hmm. Does a very good job on financial literacy.
Okay.
I've seen that Bank of Boston and Cobham Square has a program that they're doing on financial literacy. And then I've seen even in Mattapan, there's a program that some folks are standing up because there's a gentleman who said, hey, he believes that there must be much more financial literacy. And then I've seen quite a few folks go to churches, which is a great place that obviously you find many people from my community on Sundays, that they seem to respond very well in a trusted area. And so I find that the best thought, and when you say, what would my recommendation be, is go to people who we trust, because the churches, banks that we're using and the like. And I've seen the treasurer as well of the Commonwealth have an idea around how to teach financial literacy. And she actually have come up with a program that she, I think she calls it Baby Steps, that encourage families to begin with a 529, a small 529 plan and the like, to begin when a baby's born, to start to put money away for education. And then there's a whole literacy, educational financial literacy program attached to that. So it's not just put some money in the 529 plan, but build out your cash flow and the like. So there are many opportunities, but the need is great. The mistakes that are made within the community are so great that unfortunately we learn by the mistakes and not by being proactive.
Very active. Okay. Yeah, because I feel the reasons for using a budget kind of really helps accomplish specific financial goals to avoid the need to increase your debt and limit the spending and being financially stable and to track the spending patterns and your progress in what goals you have. And I think if we can really get that message out to the constituents and all in preparing a budget and how better that would help them in saving and investing and investing in themselves as well. And passing that legacy on to the next generations and the ones thereafter.
Sure. And so as I was saying, we're going through a budget process now. And one of the other ways that I try my best to engage community around budget is engaging them around the city budget.
Okay.
The city budget is somewhere in the neighborhood about $4 billion. Clearly, people understand saving and investing and the future when you're going through budgets about the city budget, when they say, hey, I want a park here, I want lights here, I want speed bumps here. And I try my best to engage them to talk about budgeting. And certainly at the state level, the $56 billion budget, when we have to make tough choices. Mm-hmm. And that's the conversation that has to continue to happen within your home, within the city government, and within state government, because there's not an infinite amount of money. Just like there's not an infinite amount of money in someone's home.
Yeah.
You have to make tough choices for the future.
That's true, because, I mean, the advantages of a budget is to control the direction of your assets and to minimize the stress and conflict and increase the chances of achieving the goals that you have set out. And understanding those various budgets is very, very important. Do you find that money challenge? Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say the bigger problem is, do you have a goal? Like, so, as they say, failure to plan is planning for failure. Many folks don't have a goal. It is more we move through life haphazardly, go from job to job to make sure that we can pay our bills, but not necessarily a goal. And so part of the conversation, I think, and as you think about this podcast, is one of the things you have to do is set a goal. Do you want a home? Do you want a car? Do you want to retire and not live off of Social Security? I mean, so much of the conversation has to be about not moving through life haphazardly.
Good point. Because I was thinking, if you're just moving from job to job, is it just you're moving just to try to get an increase, but you're not saving and planning and figuring out what you need for retirement, health care, and all these other benefits that you would need as you get older? And those kind of plannings, health care proxy, wills, trust, whatever. Even if you're in a home, have you a trust? So once you get up in older age, so you can protect your home, assets from the nursing homes if you had to go in those facilities. And so that is very important.
Sure.
In knowing and having those conversations. Do you find they have money challenges around coming up with deposits if they wanted to purchase a home? Down payments and understanding the principal and interest and all of those things that goes into buying a home.
I do. Mm-hmm. I do, but that's when I also recommend them to programs like NACA.
Okay.
And MAHA. And MAHA over on Dorchester Ave, NACA over by Jackson Square. And I encourage them to go and learn. And the city does a great job of home ownership and getting information to renters, and the mayor's office of housing has does a great job with us trying our best to connect folks to become home ownership. There's a program that we have here in the Commonwealth that we created in the last 5 years or so called Commonwealth Builders that have folks who are not necessarily earning the area median income of about $100,000, but if you can earn $60,000, $80,000 a year in your household to still get you into a home, because so much of this gap between people of color and whites is around home ownership. And so we're in state government trying our best, and city government doing all our best, to get folks from out of a renting mentality when it comes to their living situation and more into ownership, so you really invested in yourself and not into someone else.
Yeah. Do you find, also just to follow up on what you said, do they find any barriers when it comes to their credit scores and understanding what determines their credit score? And I mean, have you had any of those conversations just by chance?
Oh, yes. What's interesting is the television helps you out. There are a lot of commercials for Credit Karma and for FreeCreditReport.com and many, many things. And what's great is lots of the credit card agencies today make it so that you can see your FICO score or your credit score. So, yeah, we have those conversations because, unfortunately, we've had to figure out here in the Commonwealth what to do when it comes to people doing background checks, even for renting. So there are folks who are going to run your credit score before they even rent to you now. And so we have to let folks know that they need to manage their debt, pay their bills on time, because that also becomes a barrier, not only for home purchase, but in some cases now even for home, for renting an apartment.
Wow. Yeah, because I also noticed, like, in some of the financial institutions, I think that's a factor they look at in the hiring process is your credit score, like the banking industry. I know they used to do that some years ago. If you would get hired, looking at what your credit score and how you manage, I guess, your money and so forth.
Yeah, I know when I went to being considered for the FBI, this was years and years ago. I'm old now, but long ago, the FBI, I remember when we went through the background check, they looked at your credit reports. And because certainly for that type of job, they want to make sure that you can't get blackmailed and the like. But in so many ways, you would hope that technology today with these young folks being on these phones are able to go get these credit scores pretty quickly and be able to understand the importance, no doubt about it.
Yeah, because and the other factor, I'm not sure people realize, but that they can get a free credit report from all three credit bureaus, TransUnion, Experian, and Equifax, I guess once a year here in the state of Massachusetts.
I think a law passed federally that requires them to do that. Yes, that is correct.
Okay. And overall, so the benefit of financial literacy, it really helps empowers the people to make better decisions, and in particular, and essential for a variety of reasons. Hopefully helps them to avoid costly mistakes and also prepare for emergencies that come up. And as we said, they got to have a goal so they can be able to reach that goal. And hopefully the financial literacy instill confidence in them. Any other things that you have shared with some of your constituencies, or see that some of the programs that will help them really understand those points?
I can tell you, one of the things that I've been hearing an awful lot about is that financial literacy should be a requirement in school.
Shouldn't
be something that you have to learn the way many of us have learned it. We've had to learn it through making mistakes. And I know there's been some push. I haven't filed the bill myself, but I know there's been some push around the country that financial literacy should be right along the page with all the other literacy, because of the fact that it's something that's going to impact you the rest of your life. And so you enter this world not being able to read is just as bad as not being able to manage your money and understand the unscrupulous things that can happen to you. Did you financially? So I know there's a push to do that as well, and I'm a strong supporter of that.
Oh, great. Anything else you would like to share as we're getting ready to wrap up this podcast and share with the our listening audience around financial literacy and some of the things they can do to continue to improve and help themselves and in as far as beyond saving, investing, and building their assets, creating wealth?
I think the most important thing that I would just add here finally is what is good is that I've seen in these unfortunate days, such as when you have banks fail, when you have the stock market crashing, you have the Federal Reserve raising interest rates, what is great is that normally piques folks' interest, and they now start to get worried, and that worry should be the opportunities that we should use to teach our children to teach and ask our seniors about if they've done their planning for the future. And so I try my best to just encourage all of those around me at church and at work and in the community. When these questions of fear come up, that's a great opportunity to now say, let's learn, let's do, let's make sure that we're much more prepared. So let's use this now. Like we've seen several banks go potentially under. Let's use this opportunity now to say, make sure we all learn. That's the one last thing that I would add.
All right. Well, I want to thank you for being our guest on our podcast this afternoon and imparting some good news and valuable insight and information to us. And this will help us take control of our financial destiny and as well as impart this knowledge to our families and friends. Again, thank you for State Representative Russell Holmes from the 6th Suffolk District for being with us today. And we continue this conversation, hopefully, in the future. And I want to leave you with this quote by Yoli Marie. Don't be afraid of a budget. Think of it as a spending plan that will help you stay in control of your money. I am your host, Jerrell Riggins. Thank you for listening to the Jerrell Riggins Show. Stay tuned for our next podcast. Thank you for tuning in and take care of yourself. Peace and blessings.